Welcome back, everybody, to the second game of Union Gaming versus Sneaky Nick's Assassins. SNA walking away with quite the win in game one. And, well, we're just going to jump into the draft because, honestly, I have no preamble. I have nothing else to say. I just want to focus on game two. That's all I want in life. So we are now going to do that. The Sneaky Nick's Assassin team has Skywrath Mage and Death Prophet. Feel like I'm living a repeat of my life. It seems like every day I walk in and it's like, oh, I'm going to see a Faceless Void and then he's going to be banned away. And then I'm going to see a Death Prophet. I'm going to see many, many Skywrath Mages and Vipers and Razors. And that's all I'll see. It feels like that. I feel like I'm just living the same repeat over and over and over again. But please, Valve, please give new patch. Oh, God. Even the pros are being like, I don't even want to play the Dota game until there's a new patch. I am so, like, tired of this meta. I'm just like, yes, new patch. But no. For some reason, Valve, who had techies as a TI2 possibility, still have not given away techies. 5 seconds remaining. All the way here. Shaker. Past TI4. It's been a while since TI4. We still don't have techies. It's ridiculous. I'm going to have a goddamn riot. I'm going to have a one-man riot. That's all it is. All right. So, Earthshaker picked up by Sneaky Nick's Assassins. Oh, look. Seen that guy a time or two before. Earthshaker paired up with the Skywrath Mage. Very potent duo that is actually rather strong at roaming. 10 seconds remaining. The Union Gaming did pick up something that's a bit more interesting with the Brewmaster and Wraith King. Now, Wraith King has been pretty highly valued lately because he's either a strong, very similar to the Faceless Void, which is... Faces Void mean being offlane or a carry. And that's a big advantage when you pick him up so early on into the draft. And that's the same advantage that is kind of offered to you by the Wraith King, who is allows you to go, well, I can either sit there and farm my Wraith King as a core, or I can let him be a support. Because he works very well as both, and from that regard, he is a excellent early draft pickup because of his versatility. Rubik is now going to be picked up by Union Gaming. We had a couple of bans, Shadow Shaman and Centaur, banned away by Union Gaming, who took away, I guess, Pusher and Initiator. Centaur is very strong versus Death Prophet, so I especially like that ban. Depugna and Shadow Demon. I have yet to see. I don't think I've seen. No, I have. There has been definitely been Pugna matches. He snuck in a number of I guess, one or two games up against the Skywrath Mage. But every single team, a team picks up Skywrath Mage, they ban the Pugna in the second banning phase. Just because, one, you don't want to deal with that kind of pushing power. Right now, meta's all about team fight and push. Pugna excels at both, mainly the push, but also provides a lot of team fight. And then will just destroy your Skywrath Mage. So, that Pugna ward... being pretty highly valued right now. Nature's Prophet now picked up by Sneaky Nick's Assassins, and that should be their offlaner. 5 seconds remaining. Union Gaming should be going for a bit more of a team fight lineup. Got to make sure that Sneaky Nick's Assassins don't get an early hold in this game by being able to push down some early towers. They need some quick fighters here for the side of Union Gaming. They're going to go for the Bristleback once again. Radiant team ban. Interesting pickup, just because the Bristleback, I mean, it worked out pretty well for them in the beginning of game one, certainly with that very good start, being able to pick up several kills plus a quick tier one tower, but then he didn't seem to do nearly as much, and I guess the biggest part of the problem was that he was dealing with a lot of tanky heroes, and Bristleback, while he outputs really good physical damage and everything else, he much prefers to go up against those squishy intelligence and agility heroes. Now, this time around, Sneaky Nick's Assassins have plenty of those. because we have a, instead of an Alchemist, we have an Earthshaker. So Earthshaker isn't going to be building into a big tanky build like the Alchemist did last time. Instead of a, what was their other hero? Centaur. Instead of a Centaur, we're going to have a Nature's Prophet. And Lycan has already been banned out. So unless they pick up some sort of strength hero as their carry, and I can't really think of anyone's that are really that highly valued right now. A one position strength carry. Honestly, my brain is fried right now, so I'm not even going to think about that. In general, though, Sneaky Nyx Assassins probably don't have a whole lot of options for that now. This is going to be a different strategy in general for them, so I feel like the Bristleback, even though it failed in Game 1, it has some potential to be much stronger here in Game 2. Apparently, Sneaky Nyx Assassins feel it's going to be a Wraith King as a support. I do agree with them, as they ban away the Weaver. This should be a Bristleback offlane. Brewmaster as the mid, Wraith King, Rubick as the duo support, and we are just left now with a carry for Union Gaming, while Sneaky Nyx Assassins need a, well, they need a carry as well. It could be a mid. Death Prophet has been seen as farming the safe lane before, but much less likely. So they ban away the Mirana. The potential of an aggro try here from Sneaky Nyx Assassins would have been pretty strong, especially with the Mirana pickup. Reserve time. More interested in what Sneaky, or I'm more interested in what Union Gamer going to pick up here. Because for me, they could run an aggro try with the Bristleback and leave a safe lane solo. I'm sure Sneaky Nyx Assassins are just going to pick up some sort of big team fighting hero. I'm not really sure what's left. Most of the strong ones, for example, Razor. You would love to be able to have a Razor here. He's already taken out of the pool. They banned away the Mirana. There is no time left for Sneaky Nyx Assassin. They go for a one-position Silencer. So, holy cow. I did not see that one coming, I'll be honest. So, one-position Silencer. I mean, it's good versus Brewmaster. Or they could be, actually, they could be running a support Silencer with Skywrath Mage and then putting an Earthshaker core. Now, I am still, you know, still up in the air about the whole Earthshaker core. I know it's a lot of fun to watch. Whether or not it's fully viable, I'm not so sure about that one. And it is going to be Wraith King carry here, and Disruptor is going to be their secondary support on the side of Union Gaming. So that now leaves us with some pretty good control between both Rubick and Disruptor. The late game advantage, well, I suppose this actually depends whether this is the Earthshaker core or the Silencer core. I would say Silencer. I would lean towards, I think it's more likely it's a Silencer. I feel the Silencer is better as a core. But they, I don't know. They're dealing with, Silencer is actually a very glass cannon style hero, and if he's initiated on by Wraith King, who's able to farm up a fast Blink Dagger, or just a Bristleback getting in his face, or Brewmaster jumping in and popping his ultimate, if he makes one mistake and doesn't get off his global silence at the right time, he's screwed. These heroes are going to jump all over him, so I don't know. I don't feel that last pick was very good for the side of, oh, Jesus Christ. All right, we had a remake. Jesus. Cheese and crackers, man. All right. We're going to get this remake underway. Hopefully it's not going to take too much time. Everyone sit. We go, 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 go. Thank you. Been too long of a day to delay these with remakes and shit. All right? Too long of a day. Don't let that happen. So, Union Gaming. I think I like their lineup a bit more. I just feel like the Sneaky Nyx Assassins lineup is going to be too dependent on them not making errors. And Sneaky Nyx Assassins are a great team, but that doesn't mean they don't make errors. So I'm concerned whether it's an Earthshaker core or Silencer core. For either way, it doesn't really matter to me just because I'm not convinced about either one of them. The Earthshaker core could be viable here because they may be trying to run a high-pressure lineup with the Death Prophet to try and push down some towers very quickly and actually go for a bit more of a push squad, in which case I feel that Earthshaker does maybe have some viability there as a core position, but it's risky as all hell. The Furion as well is going to be able to add in a lot of additional push, but he's another hero that doesn't necessarily come online the fastest. And good lord! I saw this on Reddit. Toby and I have just bitched about it. Thank God he connected. But please, Valve, let us know who does not load. It's very simple. Very, very simple. I also like Sneaky Nick's Assassin's team name. I'm being sarcastic, by the way. I don't actually like it. It's a little mean. You need gaming? Come on. Pick that last hero. Disruptor. There we go. Disruptor. So, Union Gaming, strong initiation between Brewmaster and potentially Wraith King, both who can have Blink Daggers, very, very tanky heroes who are able to deal with some of the burst damage of heroes like Skywrath Mage, the magic damage of Death Prophet. We saw the way Death Prophet was kind of overwhelmed by all of those big tanky heroes. That could happen again, except for this time on the side of Union Gaming. Earthshaker, another burst damage hero. Silencer Ultimate is potentially great here, but it's got to be used at the right opportunities, and the Nature's Prophet, while he is definitely a hero, can add in a lot of push. I'm not sure if he's so strong in all-in push lineups. And here we go. So Ush is going to be playing the Silencer. Core Silencer it is, then. And, okay, well, we'll see how this works. I like the Silencer more as a core position, but again, I'm concerned about the Blink Dagger pickups here for Union Gaming and the potential for them to be able to jump onto the Silencer and initiate. Of course, last time, Ush had a very, very squishy hero, squishier than the Silencer, and he never died. So maybe this is just Ush's hero. Maybe Union Gaming need to be able to change up their the way they play to be able to start targeting those kind of squishy heroes. Granted, I know part of it was part of the drafting was a big issue, just because of the fact they had no real strong initiators, but not killing a sniper a single time is pretty ridiculous. I love this Rubik set. It's awesome. I want it. I want it. Give it to me. Like, the staff looks like this, like, derpy frog. And then those glowing eyes. The Rubik. I don't know, man. The Jester just fits him so well. Yes. Go, go, go. Go, 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 go. Go, 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 go. So, low-skilled dickheads currently sitting at a one-game lead as we go into game two. They are actually going to be running. Looks like the Earthshaker is going to be doing his dual lane thing. Well, Fluff and Stuff is also coming to the top lane. I'm not sure if that is just a ward. I believe it would be. No sense in running an aggro try with the Furion. I guess they could try and get first blood, but I don't see it being successful. So it's going to be dual lane with the Earthshaker just sitting here doing some Fissure blocking, which is going to be able to free up a lot of room for the Furion to farm up as the creep wave moves forward into the tower. He'll take advantage of that. And a faster Furion who picks up a level 6 as soon as possible is able to move around the map, have a much larger impact, and be less of a passive split-pushing farming Furion. So I do like this idea quite a bit. They only really need the Skywrath Mage to be able to harass the Bristleback, who is going to be the solo offlane here. So they don't really necessarily need the Earthshaker anywhere else. He could be pulling and that sort of thing, but if it means... If the option is either pulling or getting extra experience for your Furion, I think I would prefer the Furion, at least for those first couple minutes. The start off, attempted gank, Haste Rune, and Rubik. Got to be able to find the opening here onto the Death Prophet. Pull him back. The Thunderstruck, an excellent Fissure there, might just free up enough room for Death Prophet to be able to move out. And that could have been a great gank there for Union Gaming, but fortunately, we have the Earthshaker making the right movement. at the right time. Fluff and stuff, already putting in a lot of extra effort to force back the Bristleback. Bristleback was given some extra regen, knowing that he's up against the Skywrath Mage like this. Of course, Fluff and stuff also brought some additional Clarys with him, which Angel recognizes and is trying to pop, unfortunately, at level 1 with only Quill Spray, or excuse me, with Bristleback. He has no way to actually stop that clarity. Earthshaker now making his way back down to the bottom lane, where he's probably going to be doing a lot of pulling. Don't think they'll ever find the Bristleback kill. Seems like he's been forced back pretty heavily. Unfortunately, Bristleback is a hero that doesn't really have any other recovery mechanism. I mean, he can farm up Ancient Stacks, but he's even slower than Hidehunter is at it. So I don't think that'll really work out for him. And he's just going to have to continue to try and force this offlane to work. Meanwhile, Rubick's going to be able to catch out the Nature's Prophet. This will be a easy kill for them. First Blood will go the way of Union Gaming, as Ike's might finally gets caught out. Very, very dangerous tri lane, to say the least. And it's no surprise that Furion is the first victim. Double damage going to be picked up by the Death Prophet. What an excellent laning rune to have, especially up against a melee hero like Citadel's Brewmaster. Of course, the Brewmaster is still very, very tanky thanks to Drunken Brawler. But a little extra damage never hurt nobody, except for the enemy. All in all, I see that Union Gaming are going to be at a bit of a disadvantage when it comes to the laning phase. The middle is going to be a washout where Death Prophet will be leading in CS. Brewmaster will survive and everything else, but Death Prophet will still be ahead. The top lane matchup where you have Ike's Mike, I mean, he may have died. He gave away First Blood, but he's still picking up more experience than the Bristleback. And should continue to do so throughout the whole entire laning phase, thanks to the use of his Treants, Nature's Call, to be able to pull in the creep waves where he needs them. And even if he doesn't want to do that, he can always go back in jungle, so there are at least options for him available. So it's all going to be about this Blink Dagger Brewmaster and those first couple of initiations, the first couple of uses of those ultimates, and how successful he is with them. I think that's going to really depend on whether or not Union Gaming are able to kind of snowball that into picking up some of their early game items, or if they end up faltering. And, well, that was a questionable telekinesis. Not so sure about that. Not sure what he was trying to do. He's going to be going for the Aghanim's build here. Now, there are definitely different ways to run the Silencer. In the past, when Silencer was picked up as a carry, he was used primarily for his Glaives of Wisdom. Even the back of the day, he didn't actually have this ability called Last Word now. But nowadays, he's actually favored more for his Aghanim's plus Refresher build that is able to give you, it's 12 seconds of silence. And, oh, excuse me. 14 seconds of silence, plus a huge amount of damage from Curse of the Silence, especially once you get the Refresher. The Aghanim's upgrade is nice at first, but I feel it's really the Refresher that makes it just kind of overwhelming. And unfortunately for the Peruvians, they're going to have a bit of lag issues. I am having no lag issues, so apparently it's a South American issue. We'll see how it goes. Valve, please get some better servers for the poor Peruvians, man. It's either Brazil or USDs for them. Need some better options. Three creeps with one creep swarm. That is value right there. 27-7 compared to the 16-4. Death Prophet crushing the mid CS. Top lane, we have the Nature's Prophet, who has picked up now his second CS. Compared to the Bristleback, who has zero. So he's beating out the offlaner. And then when it comes to the two carries farming, Silencer is actually beating Wraith King, though Wraith King has slightly more denies. Well, if the players don't care, you don't care. As a spectator, It's useless. Level 4, Nature's Prophet, Bristleback. Level 3. And this is... it's actually getting harder and harder. This is the best thing. This is how you... I actually gauge success as a support like this. If you are able to... whatever you do, if you're able to keep the same level as the Bristleback, as the offlaner, I consider what you did in lane a gigantic success. Because if you're able to stay the same level, and that doesn't mean that, that can mean like zoning out the offlaner and keeping yourself both level one, or that can mean doing such an exceptional job doing double and triple pulls that you actually keep in pace with the offlaner. Either way, I think it's a huge success, and it looks like we're gonna be seeing our first push. Silencer is already level 6. IX Mike, he's coming in with his level 2 Nature's Call. They decide it's time to be able to take down the first tower of the game. Teleportation's already coming in. Rubik is going to try and do what he can with the Fade Bolt, but there's not much else he can really do. He'll draw the aggro of the Creep Wave off the tower. Nature's Call will still sit there, and the Treants will tank up the tower, but it's still going to be an inevitable push that's going to be probably too tough to defend. We actually have the Earthshaker now teleporting up to the top lane. He's going to try and push back this push that was coming in from Union Gaming. And at the very least, he's going to be able to pick up some experience here. Furion is now teleporting in, but again, just to be able to find experience. Not sure what that glimpse was about. I guess Disruptor wasn't really paying attention. He thought maybe that was a teleport in from the Earthshaker, but it was just a waste of mana at the end of the day. Phase Boots for the Brood. While Death Prophet already has treads. Bottle is obviously cycling around a bit. Pretty static laning phase, all in all. Nice Midas pickup for Ush. I think this is a pretty smart pickup from him. He's now fighting up against the Bristleback Angel, almost committing to this kill, but the silence goes out from the last word, and that's enough to force Angel back. Fluff and stuff. Whoa, there. The two supports run into each other and immediately run away. It was a game of chicken where they both lost. Oh, I love this. Death Prophet actually had a stacked up hard camp that he was farming. And that's why the Earthshaker was farming up this middle lane. IX Mike, he's going to be caught out here, and they should have enough damage to be able to kill him before he can sprout and teleport away. Sure enough, he tries to sprout, but not enough. And another pickoff on IX Mike. I'm almost wondering whether or not he should be full-time jungling at this point. Just because the first blood was fine, but the second kill now going the way of this offlane, and especially it's so easy for them to be able to get these kind of kills with the Disruptor now picking up level 5 glimpse, or level 5 with the level 3 glimpse. It's such a long range initiation that if you ever overextend yourself in lane, 5 seconds later you're going back into a terrible position where the Wraith King is just going to beat you down real quick. Wraith King also went for a hand of Midas. Midas gaming time, man. Time for everybody to farm up. Angel is stacking. It looks like he will be trying to use this again. Bristleback is pretty slow at being able to farm ancient stacks, but it's better than nothing, I suppose. Middle lane, we do have Citadel. Well, he's actually silenced up here. He should still be able to get off his ultimate. This is going to be kind of a waste for him. He gets off the clap, now gets off the ultimate. He's going to start focusing on IX Mike right away. Silencer ultimate going out, which is going to be putting an end to those pandas' aggression as they were actually trying to set up for a stun onto IX Mike. The Earth Panda is beginning to get away, though. They're going to be able to try and land a Fissure immediately as Citadel comes back out. He gets a good critical on the Fluff and stuff. Teleport in from the Furion, though, and Citadel should be falling here as he gets sprouted up and Crypt Swarmed down. Big over-aggression there from Citadel. Nice ultimate there from Ush, but he's now going to be caught out as the attempted to teleport away, but Glimpse is going to put a stop to that one. One for one, same time, Wraith King is free-farming here at this top lane. The Hand of Midas is nice on a Wraith King because levels are pretty important. The faster you get level 2 and level 3 in Reincarnation, the more active you can be in these team fights. But the last thing you want to do as a Wraith King is be that guy who gets caught out after his reincarnation pops and some 2 to 3 minutes later actually gets picked off again. Just because that reincarnation cooldown is so long. So the Hand of Midas is very good for the Wraith King because of the levels and everything else, but you have to make sure that it doesn't slow down the timing too much of your more aggressive pickups. If it is, in fact, going to be a Blink deck. Now, he may choose to go more of a farming role and go for, like, the Mjolnir, Armlet Mjolnir build, which I guess that's perfectly acceptable this game. I would rather see a Blink Dagger just because some of the range squishy heroes, I think Wraith King would be an excellent initiator, but they already have at least one initiator in the Brewmaster. Bristleback will also be trying to do what he can here, but the attempt to farm the stack now for Angel. Slowly but surely. And it looks like they got a pick off on a Sidereal. Once again, the Silence coming into play. I actually dropped him with the Skywrath Mage ultimate. No Silence really necessary when your ultimate is still on cooldown at the Rune Master. There's actually a pretty damn good amount of farm here for this Bristleback. Still, at the same time, while there's all that focus, they had the pickoff on the Brewmaster in the middle lane. Now the Tier 1 tower is practically dead as the level 2 Exorcism goes to work. And he's already got a Yule Scepter as well. Looks like Death Prophet backed up just before the tower was going to go into deny range. So, which is smart, but I think he actually could have committed to taking that tower. Felt like he was just a bit too afraid maybe of the Brewmaster. Didn't know this, but Rubick has actually stolen Silencer's ultimate. Regen in the bottom lane, but Rubick may be picked off here. Glimpse, Yule Scepter though, still goes off onto the Disruptor. There goes that counter silence from the Rubick. They're still trying to get this kill. Disruptor is barely able to get himself away from that Skywrath Mage ultimate. Meanwhile, Rubick's going to be copping a good amount of damage here from the Silencer. But he's still going to be fine. Back in the middle area, Benjamin tries to go on the Skywrath Mage, but not enough. First reveal of that Blink Dagger is not enough to actually get him a kill. I do like the aggressive pickup, though. I completely agree with it. Unfortunately for him, the problem was in the late game, he's going to be destroyed by that Silencer who is going to be going for an Aghanim. So he's going to be silenced up, lose all of his mana, not have mana for reincarnation, which is the entire point of a Wraith King. So that's why I really agree with the more aggressive style for this Wraith King this game. Picked up quite a lot of gold early on. 6,800 net worth already for the Wraith King, as they're now going to try and push into a Tier 1 tower on top of that. Angel, make sure there's no heroes sitting on the side here. No teleports are going to be attempted. Instead, it's going to be just a straight-up trade here for Sneaky Nyx Assassins as they push in for the Tier 1 tower at the top lane. Blink Dagger is going to be up soon for the Brewmaster. So double blinks are up. And a Vanguard for the Bristleback. I think Union Gaming have everything they need. They need to force a lot of fights now. Just go, go, go. Fluff and Stuff able to pick off the Rubick. Meanwhile, he is going to be picked off himself, but still pretty worthy trade all in all. Forced a lot of rotations. Disruptor Ultimate was used as well. And wow, that is... I mean, he got nothing else. He got boots and then straight up Blink Dagger, but even more pickoff. I like it. I'm just astonished that we have a Disruptor who isn't doing exceptionally well. It's not like he's finding a whole bunch of kills or something. He's got 4 assists and 18 CS, but a Blink Dagger this early on, it's pretty damn impressive. Tier 1 tower going to be denied in the middle lane as, well, that was Death Prophet leaving it pretty weak earlier, but never had an opportunity to finish it off, apparently. Invis now for the Brewmaster. And there was no vision here for the side of Sneaky Nyx Assassins. He's going to go for the kill on Ix Mike, it looks like. He may not even need anything else. The attempt to teleport away, and it's going to be good. Ix Mike manages to teleport straight away. Sidereal could have actually popped his ultimate right away and gone for the stun. But it looks like he just figured they would have enough damage to kill Ix Mike before anything else happened. Aghanim's almost halfway done already for the silencer. The blade mail is going to be the pickup here for Benjamin. Always a strong pickup with the blink dagger. Natural aggression plus the blade mail, it does a lot for you. And actually makes you decently tanky as well. Once again, we're going to see this person back with the early Vanguard, then straight into Treads. I suspect his whole entire item build may be very, very similar. But I think they really need to start forcing some fights, too. I'm not sure they're doing it aggressively enough right now, just because of the fact that they can't afford to let this game stall out into the Aghanim's upgrade. Yule Scepter, going to find the Rubik. And he's going to be immediately silenced up and bursted down. Unfortunately, the Brewmaster is just not here to be able to intercept. Angel is going to be forced back. And that's just a free pickoff. Citadel is still here. He just either wasn't close enough or wasn't willing to be able to find that pickoff. Glimpse back. Now the Brewmaster ultimate is going to be used. But the Exorcism goes out at the same time. They need to start focusing on this Death Prophet. But immediately the ultimate goes out from the silencer, stopping so much of this aggression from the enemy team. Benjamin loses his reincarnation. But it's still a great fight so far. For the side of Sneaky Nick's Assassins, they now focus on taking down the Silencer, and they do so successfully, but it's going to probably be at the cost of at least Benjamin's life. The Crypt Swarm, not quite enough, but a nuke from the Skywrath Mage will be able to get the kill. Fluff and stuff gets telekinesis up, but they're going to be able to get a Rubik kill as well, this looks like. The slow plus a couple of right clicks, and now Fisher's Summon's going to be enough. Four kills for Union Gaming. Hey, that's well worth it for them. And I believe you can even throw in five with the Disruptor dying in twice there. Or excuse me, the Rubik. Death Prophet manages to teleport herself away. Again, another lineup maybe lacking in stuns. Mech has been picked up now by the Nature's Prophet already. Ix Mike choosing to go for a lot more team fight oriented rather than... There are some aggressive Furion builds that allow you to do a lot in the early game, but they're usually based around like phase boots, early set of phase boots, possibly a Maelstrom, maybe a Blink Dagger. This one, much more team fight oriented and is going to spare the Death Prophet from having to go for a mech for herself, allowing for a quick Yule Scepter. Which is pretty necessary versus the mass initiation here from Union Gaming. You can dodge the missile from the Wraithfire Blast. You can be able to deal with some of that Brewmaster ultimate, delay some time there. And the Disruptor ultimate is another big one that if the Death Prophet does get caught in it, at least you have the Yule Scepter to help you out during that time. Looks like an early Bloodstone for the Death Prophet. I already have the point booster. I've never been a big fan of Bloodstone for Death Prophet in general. I feel they're better items for her, but I think Yule Scepter gives you enough mana regen that you can. You don't really need Bloodstone. The stats can be found in better items usually. Personally, I like just a naked mid booster can do a lot for you. Disruptor actually managing to catch out Fluff and stuff inside the ultimate. The ultimate is actually Furion ult is going to be able to finish him off as the push comes in from the bottom lane. So one for one trade in the middle. Disruptor ultimate used, which is fine by Sneaky Nyx Assassins as they take the opportunity to find some free tower gold. Ancient Stack is going to be farmed up by Angel once again. He's doing a good job finding himself a lot of farm from this. I don't normally see that, but props to him for a Bristleback really finding a lot more farm from the Ancient Stack than you normally should. It takes him a while to clear through it, but he gets to it eventually. And there it is, the Aghanim Scepter. And I am now fearing quite heavily for Union Gaming. Just because of the fact that this Silencer ult It's a 5 second or 6 second silence round, and applies the curse of the silent. So 6 seconds times the mana cost. So we're talking about almost 200 mana. Almost 200 mana burned away from Curse of the Silent by its, the global silence. Guaranteed. Guaranteed, because everyone's silenced up. Small little engagement we missed out at the top lane. Got a pick off on the Skywrath Mage. 200 mana is a good amount of Disruptor's mana. It's over half of Brewmaster's mana pool right now. That's why he's going for BKB. It's a little under one-third of Wraith King's mana, but he's also got the Soul Ring to be able to help him out. So, actually, in this regard, Wraith King is one of the few heroes who's going to be actually just fine versus that Silencer ult. It's more like the Brewmaster I'm most concerned with. He's trying to farm up BKB, which will be their way to be able to counter it, but... it's tough. It's tough to say. Disruptor waiting for his opportunity. He has IX Mike in his sights right now, but he needs some additional help, and that's where the Bristleback's going to be coming in. Skywrath Mage, oh my god, Fluff! Finds another pickoff, but I'm going to wait for this one. IX Mike should be dead now. Should be dead. There's no way he can get out of this one. As both Glimpse and the Disruptor ultimate can be used to be able to stop him. Oh no! Disruptor didn't immediately pop the ultimate, and now the Silencer ult goes off to be able to save him. Disruptor, hesitation kills, man. Or in this case, it saves, as Furion was able to walk away. Silly, silly play that really shouldn't have happened. Look at the big items being picked up now by the Radiant side. We have an outright Shiva's. Looks like this is just a naked point booster for the time being. Shiva's going to be picked up by the Death Prophet, Blink Dagger on the Earthshaker. We have, Nature's Prophet has kind of had the same, like, mech items for a bit now. Yule Scepter for Fluff and stuff. After all the kills he's been finding around the map, he has actually succeeded in being able to pick up a nice luxury item for a support like him. So they're looking damn good, and I feel like Union Gaming, their time to really start utilizing these Blink Daggers has passed. Of course, they're still going to be strong no matter what, but it's just... I think they really needed to fight more and go for it before the Death Prophet is so damn tanky, before the Aghanim's ultimate is going to wreck so many of their heroes. Once again, they give the priority of the Aegis to the offlaner. Ultimate goes off from the Death Prophet, easily being able to clean up at least one here. Yule Scepter and Benjamin May falls. His blade mail is going to be down by the time they come back. There goes the Reincarnation. Angel is going to lose his life. Teleport away from the Death Prophet. Not quite enough in time. He still gets the kill and takes away that Aegis. Nice little tornado usage. They're going to be able to find an additional kill onto IX Mike, which they need as many pickoffs as they can get right now. Double blade mails from both the Wraith King as well as the Bristleback are certainly threatening. And they're going to be tough for the Death Prophet to be able to deal with. But that was primarily on the Aegis. Jump in. An additional hero kill going to be found on Ash. Now he's trying to get himself away. Good Yule Scepter usage there from Fluff and stuff. And they may actually be able to get Ash out as he finds a cuddy hole to be able to teleport away. Tier 1 tower should be going down here in the middle lane. Union Gaming. Maybe not taking enough time to force down a tower. And Echo Slam comes out. They're going to go for Angel. Ultimate goes off from the Silencer. And they get at least that one. Benjamin now in some trouble. He doesn't have a Reincarnation. Fluff and stuff needs some extra mana to be able to finish him off. Benjamin still going to fall. Ike's Mike is going to claim that last right click there. Mass teleports come out now at the top lane where Earthshaker is going to try and pursue onto the Rubik. Does have a Blink Dagger up in just a second. And it's going to go for just one hit. All it takes. So now he almost picked up a full four staff. Necronomicon is going to be had soon on the Furion as well. And the items just keep on building. 25 minutes in, 15-9. Sneaky Nyx Assassin's currently holding a 1,000 gold lead and about a 2,000 experience lead. Which is actually pretty impressive, the way that Union Gaming have managed to keep this game within reach. despite the fact that you have both towers and kills going the way of Sneaky Nyx Assassins. If they can actually win a couple of team fights and somehow take down these towers, they may actually get a gold lead here. Death Prophet, though, has just picked up level 16. That is level 16 by 25 minutes in is really impressive experience per minute. 560 experience per minute. That is keeping up with a Wraith King who has a Midas. Shouldn't really happen, to be honest. Jump in, Disruptor looking for a pickoff. Oh, immediately gets turned around on and blown up in the process. Ush is targeted immediately by Benjamin, but it's not quite enough damage, and now he's able to get himself away. The mech heal from Ix Mike will be able to buy Ush a little bit more time. His ultimate is not quite yet up. Unfortunately, the Brewmaster ultimate will target him down and bring him to his knees. Meanwhile, our Death Prophet has been able to spread around a lot of damage so far, but not quite enough to be able to target any one hero. They're going to try and go now for the Brewmaster. Unfortunately, the blink away from Citadel will be in time, and they won't be able to find any additional pickoffs. Ix Mike is certainly going for it here, but he can be turned around on rather easily. As they start to go for him, but the rest of the team comes in force, and now Citadel's going to be picked off, and with the Yule Scepter usage, they might just find Angel as well. Beautiful Fisher block, and with that, that's going to ensure two extra kills. Nicely done, well played by Ix Mike, setting that whole entire thing up. And Union Gaming overextending themselves once again past the middle lane. This middle tier 1 tower is still up. Union Gaming are just not focusing it down like they should. It's a whole reason Sneaky Nyx Assassins has a gold lead at all, but now after a bad team fight like that, another bad team fight. Sneaky Nyx Assassins will be growing that gold lead and probably continue to snowball it even further with the Necronomicon 3 that's going to be up soon on Ix Mike and Death Prophet just being Death Prophet. They've got an amazing amount of push. In fact, I'm a bit surprised they haven't gone for it just yet, but it's probably because they know they have so much growth left in their team that there's no reason to try and force a premature push if they still have the refresher to be had on the Silencer plus level 3 ultimate. So that's an extra 8 seconds between those two things of silence. Just ridiculous. Necronomicon 3, which is obviously going to be a big pushing power as well. Stolen, Crypt Swarm. Not much Rubik can really do with that one. Fluff and Stuff is going to be coming in from the side and dropping the bomb here on the Rubik. Not even necessary. First, the ultimate goes out from the Silencer, creaming the Disruptor now. As the big tanky heroes come in with their Blade Mails, but all they have to do is kind of disengage, wait for the Blade Mails to go down, and re-engage. As now Benjamin is going to be targeted. He's not quite burned out enough, as his Reincarnation will be up. But that's still, what a great Fisher block there. It's going to be able to buy Fluff a lot of time. Citadel jumps in deeper, but again, the Sprout into this Death Prophet Exorcism rips apart the Brewmaster. 4 heroes down, and now they're going to be able to claim a Tier 2 after a great team fight for the sign of Sneaky Nyx Assassins. Dire's bottom tower has fallen. Bloodstone finished up by the Death Prophet, which is a shame, right? After just such a great team fight like that, that you get the Death Prophet ultimate, or the Death Prophet Bloodstone. If you'd actually had it before that team fight, you would now be sitting at 12 charges. But still, they certainly have enough power to be able to control the map, and they can probably take down the rest of these Tier 2s in a short amount of time. There goes that Necrobook 3. Looks like the Earthshaker. Okay. Maybe going to be going for refresher builds on an Earthshaker? Rather odd. I mean, he could go for a more, like, a purely support Lincolns and just pass off the active onto the Death Prophet or the Furion every time he wants to. Needless to say, it's an odd build no matter what it is. Now, this is currently a 3-man push here from the side of Sneaky Nyx Assassins. I feel like this is a bit ballsier play than they should be going for. Jump in, Xander. Has the opportunity to go for, oh man, again, he's going to potentially get popped before he gets anything off, finally. The Exorcism does go out. It's going to be able to clean up the Disruptor. Unfortunately, our Death Prophet has not a whole lot of room to work around, but the Shiva slowing everybody down finally gets slowed up a little bit more. Now the Earthshaker force staffs him forward a bit more. Angel's going to fall. Fisher comes in and intercepts a bit of that damage. Now here comes the rest of the team. Rubik already taken down. Silencer ultimate goes off. Benjamin going to be blown up as well as he loses his life with no reincarnation. Ush is fighting up against, oh, well-timed. Earthshaker managed to get a perfect Echo Slam right as the Brewmaster ultimate fails. Exceptionally well-timed. And that means they completely wipe Union Gaming. They may have lost the Death Prophet, but with a Bloodstone like that, she's going to be up in a short amount of time and will be able to help the team out for a mid-push, potentially. No Exorcism, but still definitely a well worth it engagement there for Union Gaming, and can probably take the Tier 2 without Exorcism anyway. There it is, the Refresher. It's up on the Silencer. Oh, man. One of the most obnoxious combinations in the game. 14 seconds of silence. 14 seconds of silence means about 500 mana loss on every single hero, which I believe, if I recall, that's like pretty much Brewmaster's whole entire mana pool. So even if that, and that's what the BKB is for, he's going to need that one, definitely. He's only sitting at 429 mana. Bristleback is probably going to be left rather low from that one as well. 800 mana pool, 500 away. He only has 300 mana to work with. It's not too terribly much. So the initiation for Union Gaming here is going to be the keyest part. If they can actually find an opportunity to be able to get the Disruptor to jump in and pop his ultimate on the Silencer and they kill him real quickly, it's a great opportunity. Great force staff there from the Earthshaker. Gets himself ahead of that kinetic field. I thought for sure he was going to be a pick off. But he may survive long enough to be able to get the rest of the team in. And here it comes. The Exorcism already being used. Sidereal forced to pop his BKB and his ultimate as well now. Yule Scepter usage, not really quite what we're going to be seeing. Fluff and Stuff once again comes in from behind. Self's Yule Scepter usage now as he skips ahead once again to try and get a kill onto the Brewmaster. He's going to lay down his ultimate right over the area where the Brewmaster is going to come back. Well played by Fluff as he ensures there was going to be no blink away from the Brewmaster because of that immediate damage. And now the attempt to push uphill with the Necronomicon 3s. Who cares if Exorcism is down? They certainly have enough units on board to be able to push this out. Brewmaster buys back, but what for? He's got no ultimate. He's not really much of a threat without it. Benjamin comes forward, pops the plate mail, but there's just not a whole lot of return fire going on. Now the Silencer ultimate goes off again. He can pop the Refresher, and this could be a winner fight. They're going to pop in second ultimate now. Benjamin's going to lose his reincarnation, but everyone else is practically dead. In fact, Angel may just take out here. As the last couple of nukes come in, a couple right clicks, and sure enough, he will fall. Wraith King, one of the last heroes left alive. Another buyback, this time for the Bristleback. And with double ults blown, Sneaky Nyx Assassin should be getting out here. Nice steal there from the Rubik, who managed to actually get the Silencer's ultimate. And it looks like they will get a kill onto Ush as he's going to be completely surrounded. Well, the rest of his team is coming in. Looks like they're going to try and bail him out here. And this could be a good opportunity for Union Gaming to find some additional hero pickoffs. They're going to find IX Mike, stun him up. And they don't get much else besides that. So another death push like that one. The next time this Silencer ultimate, I think Union Gaming got to push out, got to try and force some fights on the side of Sneaky Nyx Assassin's map, just because of the fact that the next time this double Silencer ultimate is up, I think that's going to mean Arax and possibly the game, because they do not have any buybacks. Like, they burned through so many buybacks there. The Brewmaster as well as the Bristleback. Some of their heroes died twice and died in both of those team fights, so they're not going to have gold for buybacks. All in all, I think Union Gaming are in quite the pickle here, and they can't just sit back and farm their way out of it. Aegis going to be given to the Bristleback once again, knowing that the Wraith King should always be able to always be able to have a reincarnation. This poor Rubik, man. He just gets dumped on all day. Good combination, though, between Fluff and Mike. Fluff blinking in and hitting the Ancient Seal just before the Nature's Prophet ultimate lands. Very well done. Sure enough, full refresher up for Earthshaker. So, double slam and slam jam time. I'm exhausted. I don't know why. Well, full day of solo casting can do that to you, I guess. -15 36 minutes into the game. We have currently sitting Sneaky Nyx Assassins over a 15,000 gold lead and over a 20,000 gold lead on top of that. And they're looking like they're going to be able to end the game right here. This next Exorcism plus double Silencer Ultimate. It's tough to deal with, and the only way I think you can is finding the initiation yourself. But even then, I still don't see how they're going to be able to take the fight. Nobody has a buyback, though. Not a single person. Wraith King is still farming pretty damn well, keeping in pace with the Death Prophet again, despite the fact the gigantic hero kill and tower lead for the side of Sneaky Nyx Assassin. So the fact that Wraith King is anywhere close to the Death Prophet at all is a sign of how well he's farming. Now, he no longer has a Soul Ring, which leaves him a little bit exposed to that whole double silence and all the mana burn that's going to be happening. He can actually focus a Necronomicon minion on the Wraith King. He may actually die without any mana. Now, the reason he replaced his Soul Ring is because he now has a BKB, which is going to be one of the ways he deals with a lot of this mana burn. The first Silencer Ultimate can immediately be countered by the BKB response. The second Silencer Ultimate will still be able to silence you through that BKB, but I think it won't matter by that point in time. The Wraith King will have already stunned somebody up and will be right-clicking them down, and there are no other abilities for Wraith King to be using once he stuns somebody with that Wraithfire Blast. I have to say, though, big shout-out to Fluff and stuff. I feel kind of bad because I've missed several of his kills so far just because I haven't expected him to be such a playmaker in this game. But his Skywrath is a terror. Him combined with the global damage of IX Mike, they seem to have very good coordination between the Wrath of Nature and the Ancient Seal coming in, allowing that ultimate to be able to do a lot of extra damage. But Fluff in general is just finding those openings to sneak in at the right areas and pop a hero real quick. Benjamin's going to be coming in from the side. Exorcism is going to be blown by the Death Prophet as the pursuit continues. As Benjamin tries to go on the Silencer right away. This is smart. This is what they needed. But still, one ultimate goes out. Four Staff Refresher doesn't get the second ultimate. And that's going to be bad. Buyback, second ultimate now going off. But I think this fight may already be a bit stagnated for the side of Sneaky Nyx Assassin. The Exorcism is certainly doing a lot of damage. There goes Angel as he gets blown up. Brewmaster Ultimate is also going to die there. Angel comes back. Second life coming into play now. Fluff and stuff delaying up the retreat from Benjamin as he finishes off the Rubik. Echo Slam comes in from the Earthshaker. He has a refresher as well. Doesn't even need to use it though. And GG, well played, called by Sidereal. As Sneaky Nyx Assassins, the low-skilled dickheads they are, manage to get themselves into the WePlay Atlantic main part of the tournament. So well done by them. They make it through the qualifier and secure themselves the slot to the main event. So well done by them. By the way, I'm calling them low-skilled dickheads because that's the name of their team. If any of you guys missed on that, low-skilled dickheads victory. Just in case there's a Reddit thread made later about me flaming enemy team. Flaming teams. Just making use of what they called themselves. Anyway, guys, it's been a very, very long day. And we are going to be calling it a night right here with this last game. So thank you to all of you who tuned in. If any of you tuned in from the very beginning, starting with our stream on iLeague, join Dota Red. Shout out to you. Shout out to all the new subscribers that we've been getting here on our joinDOTA channel, especially with today. If you guys didn't know, we are actually now giving away rares to subscribers during some of these events. So be sure to be checking that out. joinDOTA Red is where that's going to be happening. Tomorrow we are back. I do not believe we're going to be having two live streams, though. Thankfully, we only have one set of tournament that is going to be the iLeague starting at 13 CEST. This is the beginning of the Chinese qualifier for iLeague, and then the MSI Beat It European, the European qualifier, which is going to be featuring the lower bracket tomorrow. So we'll have some elimination games that begins at 18 CEST. So there's a bit of a break between the two tournaments. This weekend, though, is going to get rather hectic, as we have. Starting at Saturday, we have 10 CEST. We have the MSI Beat It Chinese qualifier number one. And then we also have the iLeague Chinese qualifier, which is happening at the same time. Then the MSI Beat It European winners and losers bracket finals. And then Sunday, which is just a cluster of games. MSI Beat It Chinese qualifier, iLeague Chinese qualifier, WePlay European qualifier finals, MSI Beat It grand final, and also the WePlay Asia qualifier finals. All happening on Sunday. So just a ton of crazy amount of Dota happening this weekend. Be sure you do not miss it. Be sure to check out joinDOTA, follow the channel, subscribe if you'd like to be able to support, and we will see you guys tomorrow at 13 CEST.